join us as we praise the Lord and begin with step by step.
Take back. welcome each and every one of you here today. Glad that you're in God's house. If you look at the bulletin, you can see a number of announcements. We have, I think till next Monday, but Randy's having a birthday. So happy birthday a week from Monday, and I hope you have a great day. You see other announcements in a bulletin. We want to entertain prayer requests, prayer concerns, words of praise. We want to be praying for Elwood. He is doing better now, and we're glad to hear that. And I know last Sunday we were getting news that he certainly wasn't doing so well, but praise God, he has made some wonderful improvements, and we're glad to hear that he's on the road to recovery. But sure, and continue to be praying for him. Phyllis has some tests coming up this week. We want to be praying for Phyllis as well as Tammy. Continue to be praying for her as well. We have some people that are traveling today, or have traveled this
week. Just for another really good old one, I saw the light. Mike St. Clair is going to lead us.
There's no doubt, and the storm
somewhat of a series on questions that Christians ask. And that Sunday, 2 weeks ago, we spoke about how can I know for sure that I am saved? This morning, we're asking another question, or a question that gets asked a whole lot by Christians is, how can I overcome temptation? So that's going to be the message this morning, is overcoming temptation. We know that all people goes through temptation. The first point is, it's a common experience. Noah had drunkenness. David fell into sexual sin. Moses had a temper. In the New Testament, Peter denied Jesus. And Paul argued with Barnabas. So temptation affects each and every one of us. There was a young priest that was handling confession for the first time. And an older priest was overseeing it to help him as he begins to know the proper way to do confession. So after he had been in the confession area for about an hour, the older priest met with him afterwards and said, I need to tell you one thing. After each confession, you gotta stop saying, wow. So when he heard those confessions, he knew that that was not the proper response. Hebrews 4:15 says this for us. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. We know, again, from the Bible, that everyone is tempted. So it is a common experience. We need to also understand that being tempted is not a sin, because Jesus Christ was tempted. It is giving in to that temptation where sin or evil comes about. This is not how to get rid of temptation. It's how to overcome, because it will happen. It happens to many of us. It may be a temptation that was just last night. It may be a temptation coming this week. But there will be temptation in everyone's life. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. Father, as we understand how to overcome temptation, we pray that you would bless this time. And Lord, I pray now that I may decrease, that you may increase, in Jesus' name. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 is our focal scripture this morning. Common to man, and God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. But again, reiterate the number one thing common to all people. Sometimes people say, oh man, I just get tempted all the time. And it just seems like Satan has just hit me in all different directions. Well, that's accurate, but it's not sin. In fact, it can be seen where if someone's trying to grow closer to Christ, or someone is walking closer to Christ, devil really puts up a fight. And he'll tempt from all different directions, hoping to find one that will land. A temptation. So, understand this. First of all, primary, that it is a common experience amongst all of God's people. Number two, it is a controlled environment. Again, as I said, being tempted is not evil. It is when we yield to temptation where it becomes evil or it becomes sin. And I think probably if we're all honest, we have all yielded to temptation on occasion because we're not perfect. Once again, to reiterate, if you're not trying to walk close with Christ, then Satan may just be leaving you alone a whole lot because there's no need to really tempt you. You're doing pretty good on your own. But if you become serious with your relationship with Jesus Christ, if you desire to grow, if you desire to have an impact not only in your life, but in the lives of those around you, then Satan says, okay, guys, let's let them happen. And the temptation hits. Understand, always understand this, that temptation is not the same for you as it is the person sitting right beside you or behind you or in front of you. Temptation is different for all people. Satan understands the best way to get you and the best way to tempt you. In James chapter 1, verse 13, it says, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. I have met people say, man, it seems like God just tempted me. I don't know what test he's trying to put me under or anything. God doesn't tempt people. Satan tempts people. God is in control. God, and you'll see that in just a moment, God is always in control of the whole temptation environment. In Matthew chapter 4, you'll read where Satan tempts Jesus. And you know what Jesus always referred to in that? And I know Daniel appreciate this. The book of Deuteronomy, Old Testament. Jesus went to Scripture. So, adding all that together and thinking about that, obviously we need to be in God's Word. Jesus used God's Word when he was tempted. Yet, he was tempted but was yet without sin. 1 Thessalonians 3, verse 5. For this reason, when I could not stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter might have tempted you and others, and our efforts might have been useless. Paul, writing to the church of Thessalonica, says the tempter may have come in. That's none other than Satan himself. As Paul working to plant a seed there, if you will, and Paul being concerned that the tempter, none other than Satan himself, may be trying to annihilate all that they had done. Now, here's an interesting fact. Well, let's look at this. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation exceeds you except what is common to man. We got that. It is common to everyone. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. Now, sometimes people say, I know that God won't allow me to be tempted more than I can bear, but they're almost saying like, I think he crossed the line. Because I'm being tempted more than I can bear. But understand this, folks. When God does not allow you to be tempted more than you can bear, he is not stopping the temptation or allowing you not to be tempted more than you can bear based upon what you think you can bear. But listen to this. This is powerful. But upon what he knows that you can handle. It's pretty powerful, isn't it? Well, sometimes when you look at some temptation, maybe all of us look at some temptation we've been through. I thought, my goodness, Lord, you thought I could handle that. And that's powerful of what God is doing inside of us. So be careful when we utter the words, God won't put on me more than I can handle. God won't put on me more than what he knows. So we have the common experience. We have that even in temptation, it is a controlled environment, controlled by none other than Jesus Christ, though Satan is doing the tempting. But this is powerful. There is a certain escape. Back in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13, no temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out. The King James says, I like it, says escape. He will give you an escape. Hebrews 2:18. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. Jesus was tempted in every way that you'll ever be tempted. And he understands that. And in that knowledge and know-how, and we know that Jesus is all-knowing, but in all of that, we know that God will provide an escape for his children. Now, this is where it gets a little tricky. Temptation is really not what we do. It is who we love. Or you may say it is what we love. Understanding that we've all fallen into temptation. But the real essence of that temptation is not what we do with it so much, is in fact who we love so much. And that's Jesus. I would never have an affair with my wife. I love her. I desire, though not perfect. Well, let me say it like this. You know, you can really, truly only love your spouse or only love anyone else if you first have a love relationship with God. Amen?
Amen.
Not a perfect relationship, because, well, the only thing that makes it perfect is Jesus died on the cross. So we have a perfect relationship with God based upon the blood that covers our sin. Our sin. But to love someone else, you would never do anything to hurt them. Now, I do things that hurt my wife sometimes. and it hurts. But in relating this to Jesus Christ, when temptation comes, and it's strong, right? It can be very, very strong. Who do I love? That's powerful, isn't that? In fact, it stings a little bit. Again, the King James Version uses the word escape, which denotes a small path in a canyon. So they're relating that temptation is like being in a canyon, and you're trying to get your way out of the canyon. And you see a very small path that maybe there is light at the end of the tunnel, and you see that it will lead you safely out of that canyon. Let's say the canyon of temptation, if you allow me. As a temptation is approaching, or maybe, bam, right there in front of you, there will be a moment for believers that through your conscience, or what I believe the Holy Spirit uses your conscience to show you, maybe even for a brief moment, a path that will lead you out of that temptation. But let me warn you, that path appears briefly. And if you walk past that path, the temptation's got you. Because God, the Holy Spirit, says, I will give you a way out. I will give you an escape. I have made for you an escape. Friends, as Christians, when we see the path, when we see the escape, we must immediately take that path. Because, see, what happens? The Holy Spirit and conscience says, this, what is about to happen, or what you think is about to happen, or whatever temptation you're dealing with, for a brief moment, the Holy Spirit is saying, this is wrong. Don't do it. And there's the path. When we ignore the leading of the Holy Spirit, we walk past the path. I believe there's only one path. In most cases of temptation, there's one path that you chat. You say no to it, that the temptation will become sin, because you will fall. We will fall into that. So we know there is a common experience, and that is temptation. To be tempted, it happens to all people. It is not sin to be tempted. Jesus Christ was tempted, and he did not sin. There is a controlled environment. God has said, I will not allow more than you can handle, or more than I know you can handle. And there's a certain escape. For that brief moment in temptation when the devil says, it is wrong, don't do it, the path is there, we must seize the opportunity. And let me give you some guidelines that will help in being prepared for temptations. First of all, is one that we've already spoken about. Recognize that temptation is going to come. I just don't get tempted anymore. Maybe you don't get tempted as much. That's great. But be very careful saying, you know what? That is not an issue. That is not a concern for me. Because in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, right before that is 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. And look what it says. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. Satan uses pride. And this is not only about temptation, it's about any sin. We think, man, I've just got it now. I got it handled. Be careful. Be careful you don't fall. Realize it often happens on the spiritual high. Before you leave here today, you may say, God, I just need to battle temptation. I need your power and your strength, and I want you to help me overcome that. Well, be ready. Because Satan's going to say, okay, let's see what happens. David, when he had his great victory and he had conquered many lands around him, and his troops were sort of taking care of some things here and there, he decided to come home and stay there. If you remember there, in the midst of great victory, in great recognition that God had done it for them and done it for King David, is when he was on his castle and looked down at Bathsheba and fell into sexual immorality. Sometimes it's on those highs. When I can't be touched now, it's when Satan tempts. We have to recognize, now the request, pray before it happens. Pray before it happens. Matthew 26:41. Watch and pray so that you will not fall in temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak. Boy, isn't that true? I don't think there's a single one of you in here right now saying, you know, wait, I can't wait this thing's over so I can get back out there and see. We know it is weak. And we need to pray. Let us not be naive that when the temptation comes, then I'm going to hit my knees and pray. No, you need to be prepared for temptation. You remember what it said in the Lord's Prayer? The last verse of it? And lead us not into what? Temptation, but deliver us from evil. Each day that you begin your day, Lord, I know today that Satan's going to try to tempt me in some way, some shape, some form. Lord, I need your power, I need your strength to overcome that temptation when it comes today. Jesus' name. Daily. Say, oh, do I need to do it daily? Do it once a week, once in a whole. Listen, one thing in praying with God, it also is a reminder to us that I know temptation's coming today. Because temptation will slap you up the side, right? You're not expecting it. If you say this coming Thursday at 9 a.m., there's going to be temptation, you go, okay, I'm going to be ready. It don't happen like that. So don't try to get spiritual at the last moment. Request, pray before it happens. James 4:7, resist the devil and he will flee from you. So we need to resist the devil. Praying, Bible study, put some room between you and the devil. He don't like where we're in prayer. He don't like when we're in Bible study. And then the last one is just straightforward. Run! There are basically three areas in the Bible that the Bible says run from them. Get away from them. Don't be around them. And it's immorality, greed, and idolatry. I was listening to evangelists, and they said, what you need is a good pair of running shoes to overcome temptation. There are so many different temptations, but friends, if there's temptations, I know at both of my sons' houses, they've got so many, and I'm not saying they're doing anything wrong with those, but they got so many streaming things that ever hear, well, it's going to be streaming on this, it's going to be streaming on this, it's going to be streaming on this. If you get on this, you're going to be streaming on this, streaming. And there's just so many streaming things out there now. And remote control, my goodness. You remember when remote controls had about three buttons on them? Now it looks like a doctoral student that's trying to, Texas Instrument, trying to do some kind of mathematical problem that you can't even come up with. There are so many buttons on the thing. Children have the capability of seeing almost everything on TV. You can say it, so do adults, right? If that's an issue, get it out. Run from it. If that's an area of weakness, don't give Satan help. Get rid of it. If it's idolatry, if it's greed, man, it's just all about making money. Stay away from those situations. There was a gentleman that said, well, he had just said that he was going to give up donuts because he just started gaining so much weight. I guess I can stand in front of the mirror while I tell this. And he said that he wanted God to help him with donuts. And he had done so well for about 6 weeks. Well, he came to work with a donut. And one guy said, Carl, aren't you, didn't you give up donuts? He said, well, I did, but when I got up this morning, I was so tempted to just go get one donut. And I prayed to God about it. And I said, God, if the parking spot right in front of the donut shop is open when I go by, that's a sign I can get a donut. He said, on the 12th time around, it was open. There are times that folks we give the devil a wing. We need to pray to God. If God leads us, God directs us, we need to close those doors. Overcoming temptation. It's a challenge. I would like to see us in the future sometimes. I guess it's sort of hard to do this, but, you know, I always think in church sometimes we ought to celebrate what God's doing in our life each week. And sometimes before prayer time, I say, let's just open up. Tell me what God's doing in your life. What lessons has He taught you this week? Because I know God is doing some wonderful things in people's lives in this church. And we need to celebrate that. Let's overcome temptation by the Word of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, it is nice to know that the battle of temptation was even one that was fought by Jesus, fought victoriously. Lord, it seems like with God's people, Satan works overtime in tempting us. Lord, let us, as we study God's Word, let us put into practice those things that more and more and more we can say, we've had victory, we have overcome Satan's temptation. We'll give you all the praise and all the glory, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand if you wish and join us as we sing, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. Father, Lord, thank you for this day. Father, we rejoice in you that, Father, you have given us a way out, a path out of temptation. Father, we know that we are saved by grace. We are heaven bound
And Lord, today we celebrate with this food. We thank you for the food, for those that have prepared it. May it nourish our bodies. And in return, may we use our bodies to serve thee. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.